Some of us are more concerned about accounts given by men and women in the kingdom of man than the accounts given by those of us who have authority to give an account in the kingdom of God. Shame on you. I feel sorry for you. When one esteems the value of man above the value of God, when one esteems the praises of men above the praises of God, I feel sorry for them. Of 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, to show you what the Apostle Paul said about the gospel being the kingdom and the kingdom being the what? 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses number 8 through 12 is where our interest lies. Let me see if I have that right. Yeah, that's it. Verses 8 through 12. Can the church say amen? Again, this epistle is written to the born-again New Testament believer. These individuals are already saved. Thank you for attending to the matters. Verses 8 through 12 of the second chapter of 1 Thessalonians. If you have it, can you say amen? Let's read. So Paul says, so being affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only. So please underline, what did Paul and his company impart? Not the gospel of God only, but they did impart what? The gospel of God. So when we preach the gospel of God or the gospel of Jesus Christ or the gospel of the kingdom, there's only one gospel. It is imparted to those who receive it through preaching or through the expose, expounding by the individual preacher taking the pulpit and exegesing his text, and through his thorough exegesis explaining the plan of salvation concerning the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And through this preaching takes place under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Someone say impartation. So the Apostle Paul speaks for himself. He says, we were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only, read, but also our own souls, because ye were dear unto us. We were willing to sacrifice our lives for you. This is how significant and important, someone said, the gospel of God is. This is how it is. Read on. For ye remember, brethren, our labor and travail, for laboring night and day, because we would not be chargeable unto any of you, we preached unto you the gospel of God. Please underline that. For it has been mentioned now a second time. What do we preach? The gospel of God. The gospel of God is the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the gospel of God. The gospel of God is the gospel of the kingdom. The gospel of the kingdom is the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the gospel of God. Can the church say amen? Verse 10, ye are witnesses. God also, you're a witness and God's a witness. You bear witness because you received the impartation. God's a witness because he is the one that gave us the gospel to preach and bore witness. Read on. How holily and justly and unblameable we behaved ourselves among you that believe. We were holy, we were just, and we were unblameable. Someone say holy. Shout it. Someone say holy, just, and unblameable. So our behavior was a reflection of what we preached. And what we preach was demonstrated and confirmed through the assertion of the behavior of holiness, justification, and being unblameable. Can the church say amen? So we weren't a hindrance. Someone say we weren't a hindrance. This is what the Apostle Paul is saying. We didn't preach one thing and live another. We didn't say one thing and do something different. We were an example of what we preached and taught. And I certainly can say that of myself here for the 38 years, 37 years, whatever it's been, that I have been here at the Greater Bible Way Temple of the Apostolic Faith. Can the church say amen? Yet I don't want to boast because I'm still a young man. Come and say hallelujah. And we're not supposed to boast anyway. Verse 11, as ye know how we exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you as a father doth his children, that ye should walk worthy of God, who have called you unto his kingdom and glory. So, Reverend, it should be clear that God calls us to his kingdom and glory through, someone say, the gospel of God. So the gospel of God is inseparable from the kingdom of God. The Apostle Paul has made it clear here that she would walk worthy of God, who have called you unto his kingdom and glory. Can the church say hallelujah? Now this is sufficient. You read the rest in your spare time. But this is to make that point. When we are born again, we have come into, someone say, the kingdom of God. We are in the king's domain. We are in his dwelling place. We just read the prophecy. He is our dwelling place. He dwells in Zion. In him we live and move and have our being. Let us go now to Colossians chapter 4. Back it up a few. Someone say back it up a few scriptures, because it is right before Thessalonians. Colossians chapter 4. Verses 7 through 18. This is one of the Apostle Paul's prison epistles. He will allude to such. In Colossians chapter 4, verses 7 through 18, and all the people said amen. And he mentions a number of names of those men and women who are part of his company. Paul's company consists of Barnabas, Silas, Timotheus and Titus, Gaius and Aristarchus, Aquila and Priscilla, John Mark and Demas, just to mention a few. We will read of some of those further names in the fourth chapter of the book of Colossians, verses 7 through 18. If you have it, can you say amen? Paul says, now all my state shall Titius declare unto you his, who is a beloved brother and a faithful minister and fellow servant in the Lord. Please underline these four descriptions of this one individual, Titius, who was a member of Paul's company. He is described as a beloved brother, number one, a faithful minister, number two, a fellow servant, number three, in the Lord. So this is what those who are working with ministry are supposed to be to every pastor, to every bishop, Suffragan bishop and district elder. Those who work under the authority of ministry are supposed to be beloved, faithful in their ministry, fellow servants in the Lord. Can the church say amen? Verse 8, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that he might know your estate and comfort your heart. Not know your estate, but know your estate. This means know how well you're doing both naturally as well as spiritually. The totality of the sum total of the whole man. He's interested in you prospering and being in health even as your soul prospers. This should be of importance to the child of God, that if you're sitting on the ministry, the minister and our ministers should be concerned about your total well-being. Not that they can do anything about it, but certainly anything that they can do to support and help, to build up and encourage, or to add to, admonish, exhort, and edify. That is our responsibility to do so. And all the people said amen, say amen again, and comfort your hearts. How does the minister comfort the heart of the believer? The Bible talks about the comfort of the scriptures. We are supposed to find comfort in the scriptures because the Holy Spirit is called the comforter, and it guides the believer into all truth, which is the right division of the scriptures. So our comfort is supposed to come not from the preacher holding your hand, can we say amen, but from the preacher rightly dividing the word of God. Can the church say hallelujah? It goes a lot further to receive comfort from the breath of God being blown on the believer than the bad breath of the preacher. Can the church say hallelujah? I'm teaching hard tonight. Verse 9, with Onesimus, a faithful and beloved brother, who is one of you. Now this, again, the Bible says, know then that labor among you. So you should know, I should know who is one of us, who is a good saint, a faithful fellow servant, a fellow brother or fellow sister. We should know one another. If we would follow the instruction of the pastors in our churches and be faithful to the assemblies as required, then the pastor would be able to give the appropriate account of the individuals who are members of his congregation to the degree that he has the ability to do so. Can the church say amen? And so now, with Onesimus, Onesimus was what some refer to as a runaway slave. He is supposed to have run away from his master Philemon. He came to the Apostle Paul while Paul was in prison, and the Apostle Paul preached the gospel to him, imparted the gospel to him, and he was translated through the new birth experience into the kingdom of God's dear son. What's his name? Oh, yes. Someone say, oh, yes. And this is how it was. So Onesimus now is a member of Paul's company. He has value. He has status. What is his status? He's a faithful and beloved brother. Please underline that. Someone say faithful and beloved. Whereas at one time he was a runaway slave, now he's a born-again believer, and the apostle was the greatest man in the New Testament, who was the author of two-thirds of the New Testament, and given the apostleship to the Gentiles, speaks of this Gentile brother now as being a faithful and beloved brother. This is the lofty account given of the child of God now that he's been born again of water and spirit. And some of us are more concerned about accounts given by men and women in the kingdom of man than the accounts given by those of us who have authority to give an account in the kingdom of God, shame on you. I feel sorry for you. When one esteems the value of man above the value of God, when one esteems the praises of men above the praises of God, I feel sorry for them. And I'm not saying anyone did that in my television audience. Don't frown at me in my television audience and those in the congregation. I'm not casting any accusations upon anyone. I'm simply making the point that when we are more concerned about being accepted in the kingdom of man and the confines of these institutions that men have set up to make themselves feel good about themselves, above and beyond the account that is given by those who were in Christ before us and have the responsibility to give the account about us, we are misguided in our revelation of truth. Well, Paul's account is Onesimus was a faithful and beloved brother who is one of you. Verse 9, they shall make known unto you all things which are done here. So he was sending Onesimus as a messenger. The term messenger can be translated to the synonym as an angel. He was bringing the report of the Apostle Paul concerning the work that was being done by Paul and his company when the Apostle Paul was incarcerated at this time and was unable to bring the report himself. He is in Paul's stead. This was a noble undertaking. Can the church say amen? And then he says now in verse number 10, verse 9, they shall make known unto you all things which are done. Someone say down here. Must have been south of where they were. Verse number 10, Aristarchus. Someone shout Aristarchus. My fellow prisoners salute you. So Aristarchus is incarcerated with him. Aristarchus is in prison with him. My fellow prisoner. Please underline those terms. Some people think when they are incarcerated, Reverend, that they are impeded, hindered from doing what God has given them to do. But isn't it interesting? The Apostle Paul used his own personal incarceration as an opportunity to write epistles that are now etched in the archives of eternity of our canonicals and are being written in the hearts of the believers throughout the seven continents of the earth. Millions and even billions are being effectuated, influenced by the impartation of the words of the Apostle Paul as he was inspired by the Holy Spirit. God is using what Paul left 2,000 years ago to be instructed in Bible classes all over this country and throughout the world, and individuals are taking the words of this man as inspired by the Holy Spirit and going on to perfection. This is an inexplicable miracle. Can the church say amen? Well, Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, salute of you, Paul says, verse 10, and Marcus, sister's son to Barnabas. This is John Mark, with which he had much trouble early on in his ministry on the first missionary journey, the very one that he didn't want traveling with him. Obviously, at this time, someone say there had been reconciliation. Obviously, he had reconciled with John Mark, Barnabas' nephew, if you will, and now he is recommending him as a part of his company. And Marcus, sister's son to Barnabas, touching whom you receive commandments, if he come unto you, receive him. Because before, he didn't want him anywhere near the work he was doing. But now, he and Mark have reconciled. Do what? Someone say, receive him. When there's reconciliation, there's reconciliation. When the relationship has been restored, it's restored. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. If you're back in right standing, you're back in right standing. And you walk with God. Can we say amen? Verse 11. And Jesus, which is called Justice. Again, this is not Jesus Christ. This is a Jewish brother in that day, no doubt, who had the same name. But his name also is called, someone say, Justice. Who are of the circumcision. Didn't I tell you that these were Jews? Someone say, these were Jews. Read on. These only are my fellow workers. Now he refers to them, underline this, as what? Someone say, fellow workers. Which is what all of you are here tonight that are in the congregation. You are fellow workers to Pastor Combs, or you're supposed to be. You're supposed to be able to be depended on. You're supposed to be able to be trusted. You're supposed to be able to be delegated authority to. You're supposed to be able to carry out a baptism. Carry out an instruction on the plan of salvation. Carry out a duty to pick some up and get them here on time. Carry out following through to encourage people to come to church on Sunday morning. You're supposed to be doing some kind of work to contribute to the growth of the church, the spreading of the message of the gospel, and the expansion of the kingdom of God. Can the church say amen? Verse number 11, these only are my fellow workers unto the kingdom of God, which have been a comfort unto me. So we are supposed to be fellow workers unto what? Please say it out loud. And this is not the kingdom of man, brothers and sisters. I certainly do a lot of work in the kingdom of man. I work for the betterment of the city of Jackson, the county of Jackson, the state of Michigan. I work for the betterment and for reconciliation between the governor and the ministers of Flint, Michigan, and have held a number of meetings and sat with the governor in an attempt to bring understanding and reconciliation to the situation in Flint, Michigan. Where were you? I guess you were busy in the kingdom of man in another location. But that was not work in the kingdom of God. That was work in the kingdom of man. I've done many, many years of work in the kingdom of man in healthcare, providing housing for persons with disabilities and supports and helps, and working with interdisciplinary teams and clinicians to make certain that individuals make a successful transition from the institution to the community-based setting. I have allowed my skill set to be used in that kingdom for that purpose because that is my responsibility contractually and morally. Can the church say amen? But nothing that we do compares to the work that we do in the kingdom of God. The psalmist said, you can build cathedrals grand and tall. You can build skyscrapers large and small, but only what you do for Christ will last. Can the church say amen? So let us make sure we have, someone say, our priorities in order. This would seem minuscule and trivial. The Apostle Paul in a jail cell somewhere, appealing his case to the Roman Supreme Court, being incarcerated, and writing these words on some papyrus somewhere 2,000 years ago, and handing this script to someone to preserve and to carry from one church to the other that we'll read about in this moment. But isn't it interesting that God preserved these very words from 2,000 years ago to be taught as the word of God in the 21st century at the Greater Bible Way Temple in Jackson, Michigan, which was non-existent 2,000 years ago. The Bible said he preserveth his word. The Bible says his truth endureth unto all generations. God knows what he's doing. Can the church say amen? Politicians will come and go. Louis Farrakhan was very critical of Barack Obama. If you pull him up, he is now making some very, very shall I say, negative comments about the president. I don't have anything negative about the president, except that I don't agree with him on gay marriage and don't agree with him on abortion. And don't agree that the government is the answer to everything. Bless Louis Farrakhan and made some very poignant, critical statements that President Obama has failed the black community, that he has left black folks dying in the streets while he pushed the gay agenda. In so many words, his statements are accurate, but I do not join the chorus of voices to criticize the president. I simply do not agree with his pursuits, his policies, the things that he has placed there before Congress to ratify. But may I say to us that we all should put our confidence not in man. The Bible said that if you trust in man, or cursed is the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, for his heart shall depart from the Lord. The book of Jeremiah. So if we're going to put our confidence in these politicians, we're going to find ourselves out of fellowship with God. We pray for them, we speak truth to them, and we put our faith in God. And for those who are voting, if you find nothing good in Donald Trump or nothing good in Hillary Clinton, then write in the name of Jesus Christ. You say that's a waste of time. It's only a waste of time if you don't believe God, because the government shall be upon his shoulders one day. So for you to think that you have to vote for someone who is unregenerated and ungodly, to say that you cast your vote shows how foolish and unlearned you are. No, you write in the name Jesus. Some people aren't worthy of any support, no matter who they are and what their name is. And you ought to know better than that. And all the people said amen anyway. So now, verse 12, Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ. Here's, turn to someone and say, here's another compliment. One of you, that means he's a saint, he's a Christian, and he is a servant of Christ. Reverend Williams Reed, salute of you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers. Now here is where prayer is recorded as being a significant ministry in the church, a spiritual eternal event. The description. It didn't say he preached all around and picked up big offerings. It didn't say he was on the PAW docket for the national convention. What it did say is he saluted you, which means he sends his Christian greetings, and he's always laboring fervent for you in prayers. This is why I approached one of our evangelists tonight, told him to call the other.